computer. And share screen to screen two. There we go. Okay, sorry. So HTTP GET and POST messages then pulling responses out of POST messages. We're going to look back at asynchronous behavior because everything you get from the database is taking time to go across the network. Then we'll talk just very briefly about JSON and RESTful APIs and then Project 3 and this week's homework. And I have a couple exercises in here actually make sure you're able to do parts of these things before I let you out in the last week before Project 3. I guess the first thing is on homework 10. I have seen, I think, only a couple homework 10s come in. Folks are still feeling kind of stuck on homework 10. Is this a fair statement?
Yeah.
Okay. Almost universally. So we ought to talk a little bit about where people are stuck on that, it's one that I thought was going to be a little bit easier homework than some of the others. That video I did yesterday trying to go through just the very step-by-step of what needed to be done for homework 10 seems not actually to have hit the mark with some folks then. You haven't seen it. Okay, gotcha. Then I'll ignore the fact that you guys are stuck. Who is still stuck at the point of not having their database table in the SQL Server database? If you go into my SQL Workbench, can you see your table with the information in it that that you need? You guys have that step done now as well? Yeah, okay, cool. So it is just a case of getting the stuff out of there. Okay? And so let's kind of walk through the pieces that I wrote down in the Slack channel yesterday. I'll ask people where on there they are wanting a bit more explanation. I have to remember what I said is why I'm going back to the Slack channel. And you guys got that okay and found that the explanation in the Slack channel actually got you through things, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Cool. Good. You couldn't log into the new server? Or you couldn't move things up onto the... You can SSH into the new server then, and then you can get clone on the new server to pull your project to the new server? Yeah, okay. And then you have to start the web server on this one. It's not running automatically, so you do the node and then the name of the JS file. Okay, there you go. Yep. That is step six on the list that is on the Slack channel. Okay. Are there specific things that were on there that people want me to go over in more detail, or should we kind of forge on at the next break? I'll just run around and help individually, because it seems like people might be stuck on different points of this. Yeah.
Is that the code that said the function of the printed employees, and then when you're on the other side, when like employees dot and you said like the name or the ID, does it matter if it's employees? Like, how should
Oh, absolutely. You just have to make sure it's the same on both sides. If we look at that example, let me, oops, I'm not on your screen, I'm on my screen. In here, this is a slightly modified one. We're on today's example. Let me go back to the old one. So in here, I am passing it to this EJS template using listings, and listings are the row of information out of here. So if I used a different name, say stuff rather than employees, then pass that through and the where clause you can ignore for right now, then those listings, when I come through to the simple one EJS side, are going to appear in this case as item.name and item.location because that's how they appear in my table. So as long as you keep in sync with what's actually in your database, then those can be whatever you want them to be. Okay, so you still have your table called employees. Gotcha. So yeah, as long as you change your table, this just has to match what your table actually is. Okay, well, our first break, our first section is going to be following a tutorial on debugging in Node.js. And if you are still having homework 10 problems and want some help on that side before you get to debugging, if you never actually got Visual Studio Code debugging working, it would not be the end of your world. Break number one or exercise number one, kind of choose your battles carefully. I do want to talk about debuggers, though. You guys have been using a lot of console log statements and looking at the console itself and then looking at Chrome developer tools for those console log statement outputs. And that's a really good way of debugging. I do a lot of that even when I do have a debugger available. But it's not the best way of debugging, and particularly when you're talking about server-side code. This is code that never runs in the browser, and so your Chrome developer tools can never see that. Your console log messages come out somewhere different. Let's actually, I guess I closed my Git Bash window. Let me open a Git Bash window show you what I mean by that. Oh, I keep forgetting my system is so slow with the recording running. It's painful. And CD into untangling, and CD into node, and CD into simple node, and make sure that this is where I've actually been working. It is. And so I'm going to node SQL underscore EJS example. There we go. So when I'm actually outputting stuff on console log, in this case, it's not coming to my Chrome developer tools. And if I were to go and look at my localhost 8000 here and open up my developer tools, I wouldn't actually see anything where we're normally looking for console log messages because this is server-side code and not client-side code. And so debugging on the server side is actually very difficult in that you don't have any of the things that Chrome developer tools give you for client-side debugging. I have a little bit of stuff on here. I can actually look at the console window and see things that are spat out. But if I spit out a whole object, it takes up pages and pages, it's really hard to parse through. And so the way that I actually far prefer to debug on the server is, let me get out of this. There we go. Through Visual Studio Code directly. I don't know if you've explored this little bug icon over here, the debug window. If I launch from there, then that's actually going to launch a debug process inside Visual Studio Code. And there are a couple things you have to set up to enable this, but once you have that set up, it's a really fairly powerful debugging experience. You see it's popped up this debug console, and that's where all of my log messages are going to appear. So that's basically doing the same thing as the console window over here was previously. In fact, it is a console window. And I have access to a full terminal window within Visual Studio Code to mess with that. But that's really not where it stops. And what makes it so useful is that as I go into the code here, and let me not be in simple one EJS. I would rather be in, I guess I don't have open the one that I want to be in. Let's open the SQL EJS example where I thought I was. And let's say that I want to set a breakpoint when the about page is opened. I should now be able to go to my page, and when I click on about, it will still show me my about. Really? Is this not where my breakpoint is? Oh, I might be in async. Sorry. When I ran this, I could have actually been running from the async version of this, and I just put my breakpoint in the old version of this. Let me try this again and see if I'm right about that. Yeah, it's still in async. I can see no lazy SQL async.js. Okay, to show this example, I'm actually going to have to go back to the new version. I haven't actually shown you yet, but I'll show you the debug version in this anyways. Same stuff. I've got an about page. And if I wanted to see what was going on in my about page, I could set a breakpoint right here. I go back to my home page. That's great. I go back to my about page, and then it's going to break into my debugger. And when it breaks into my debugger, I can see a number of really useful things. First of all, I can step over statement by statement. So if I just want to go one statement forward, I just hit that step forward button. And secondly, I can see all of my variables. Right now, drinks is undefined, if you'll notice up here. If I step over the next line here, I'm going to see it step over drinks, and now drinks has an array of three objects. And so it lets me go through piece by piece in my code and see what each line is doing. And if I'm having a problem on one line, I can go ahead and set a breakpoint right before that line and then step through it and step into it and see what that problem actually is. And so the ability of a debugger to access live code and see what it's doing on the fly is something that a lot more complete development environments like Visual C++ or C# or something like that give you just natively. With web development, it's really only on the server side that you usually get to all of this functionality. Visual Studio Code is capable of doing combined client-server debugging, though. We're not going to talk about how to set it up tonight. It's a little bit more involved. You can actually get all of these capabilities of stepping through your code either on the client or the server. It just happens to be a little bit easier on the server. And I'm going to encourage you in the first exercise, if you don't have homework 10 problems or configuration problems you're snagging me on, to go through the little tutorial on how to set up server-side debugging. Questions about what's so great about debugging and why I'm so enamored of server-side debugging? Okay. I'll let you play with it, and hopefully that will make it more clear. So here's the tutorial. We'll come back to that, more details. I just wanted to be in the slide deck so you can go back and look at them afterwards if you want to go through that. In the tutorial that we're going to look at for exercise one here, there's something called a generator being used. This is something I wanted to talk about for just a minute. In some sense, the simple node project of mine that you forked is kind of like a generator, or more like a boilerplate, actually. A boilerplate and a generator are very similar concepts. A boilerplate, you just kind of edit by hand and make it what you want, but it's a project that's set up kind of like what you want that you can use as a starting point. A generator is taking this one step further of when you run a generator, it'll ask you things like, what's your project name? What's your page layout? What's the title text? And you'll put these things in, and then it will create the pages for you that implement this. And so it's kind of like getting that head start of running your project without having to type all the code to get to that point. And some generators can be incredibly complex and full-featured. There are generators out there that will generate your database structure and your code and your web page and the back-end logic. And it's really great time saver when you find a generator that fits what you're doing well. The gotcha in generators is you have to know what they're doing. And so it's really easy to run a generator or use a boilerplate that has stuff in there that you don't really fully understand, and then you get yourself into deep, deep trouble. And so if you're using generators, make sure that you understand what the generator is generating for you. I'm not going to talk about this much. We've touched on build environments a few times, and this neat video popped across my feed yesterday, yesterday, and I thought you guys might enjoy it, but I don't really have the half hour to devote to it today, and it's kind of tangential to doing your project three, so I'll just leave it there if you're interested. So for exercise one, and again, please feel free to either do this on debugging, or if you have homework 10 problems you need me to help with, focus on that first, because all the stuff you need to do this exercise is in the slides here, and you're welcome to ask Slack questions later if you need help on homeworks right now. Follow the tutorial that it says we just went through. In fact, I didn't go through the tutorial. I think I'm going to go through the tutorial after I give you guys a chance to work on the tutorial because then problems that you hit, I'll be able to talk about as compared to now. You just look at it and go, oh, okay, yeah, that's all fine. We'll go through on my screen the tutorial here in just a few minutes. But I'll let you work away on that. Now, the prerequisite to this is to install Node.js locally. We had that on the last slide or second to last slide of last week's lecture. If you've not done that step, the rest of this is going to break horribly for you. So make sure you've got Node.js installed before you go through that tutorial. I think the link is actually on the first page of the tutorial. So leave it there for 10, 15 minutes. Work on that or work on homework 10. And I know some of you have homework 10 questions you want me to hit me on.
So you can't ask.
Good. Oh, good. 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 Good.
So think about what your
just because I wanted an unmodified one. Okay. So in this, in its unmodified form, it does not actually matter what this is called. This could be as long as this, because what's being returned in this, is the entire robot drill
Thank
You're on the server, you should be able to say node. It's a node space minus D for success. So node's installed. And so it is letting you say node. It's generating right away. I'm expressing it.
Oh,
you have to start your dependencies on the end space install.
How are you getting on, Rory? This is the thing.
If you're running Node.js, it wouldn't in this case be where you are. Okay.
So I installed it, and then now it's doing massive. So we have to log back in again.
No, that's not. That's not even the database access. It's the base.
Yes, have it on the end.
Are you still on the local or your local first response? And if I run to zero. And you just use your Git call, so you have the same version of server that you do with that one. You say Git call, I'm sure. And you can push after you change the password of that password. You do the add Git connect after that password change. You can say this SQL JS.
Yep.
No, we don't, that's just on server.
Yes, it did. Instead of responding to the president, they respond to the
president. It's working now, that's all that matters.
Yeah.
program anyways. Oh, I guess that should be the coolest thing. It's not working.
Yeah, exactly.
So we got it working.
So now we just need to find a way to make the thing.
Yep.
So do we just.
So you'll edit the SQL EJS example, and then you'll edit the simple one EJS. And I tend to do that on my local chain and get that to commit. So I don't do any kind of server. Another cheers of success.
The SSH or the screen session?
Is this actually a test?
Oh, no.
You were actually in the screen.
Oh, it was?
The screen is terminated. So you're still on the server, but you didn't have these things with your AI. And now you're asking for your SSH.
Okay.
Yeah. Layers upon layers. So yeah. <I'm there. laughs> Okay, have you guys a frustration level then?
Your passing message is Okay.
That's essentially the same thing as going down that.
Okay, people at reasonable breaking points and want to go back to talking about stuff or want 5 more minutes, or where are people? 5 more minutes? Got one? 5 more minutes? Okay, I've got 2 5 more minute requests. We'll stay at 5 more minutes then.
Oh. Yeah.
And he's going to the one that the
if you wanted to, on the more complicated query, you could do a right inner join, left outer join, head of inner, they got all the slots in the box, plus multiple tables in the front. Because you've done that before. It does on that one, and that's because that's the simplest software you can get. It's giving things from the table. Whatever software you get, you never have to be joined to probably one of the tables. So many people per turn next to the table. So, and those rows are involved in one table, which is much or it could be a couple of times. Very good. Okay, so let's look at your code because you're in here, not here. And scroll on to the top. Let me see, specify test four here. So you can actually do the same available. It's a pretty interesting thing. And the places that you need to be consistent is you call whatever you want here, you get whatever you specify to that, or you get a variable, and then down here you can see that variable, and you call that whatever you want to do, or you can get a reasonable one that you can get. So if I call this can't keep it all, you want to be reasonable one that you can
Thank you.
So the query guy, and I'm gonna, since you can't find it here, I'm gonna pull it up online and put it on the big screen there.
Okay.
So on this side, where I'm saying the query statement, and then I get my this kind of whole row. So this is going to pull my not fucking back from the database with all the data that is going to go through these. And these rows are equal to the rows that are being called from the query because it goes into the variable list. So I have an array of all my rows that I've selected. And if I... Nope, it's an whole array of things, that's right. And so then what I'm doing with that, is I'm passing through as the word listing. And then that's going to assemble one EJS partial. That's right. And what I could do is
these listings, this listings corresponds to this, but if I wanted this to be called something else in my template, that could be anything. So if I want that to be foo or foos, that can be foo. As long as when I'm in simple one EJS, I also make it foo. Okay, our 5 minutes up? Everybody ready to go on? Yay? Kind of? A little bit? Okay, let's plow on. So what I wanted to next here was... and actually, let me get a show of hands of how many of you got to the debugging thing how many actually want to go through more on the debugging thing, or shall I get through the pieces that are kind of essential for Project 3? Essential Project 3? Nobody is screaming out for me to walk through debugging in more detail? Okay. Debugging is very cool. Read the stuff on the slides. If you want to try debugging that stuff, play with it. It is very good to play with. It's the most efficient way of doing development, but you don't absolutely need it for Project 3. So let's go on to Project 3. Thanks. So the thing that the SQL example we've been looking at is presenting data from the database. And stuff in homework 10 that y'all have been struggling away on is taking stuff from the database and throwing it up on a web page. And this is great, but there's no user interaction there. The user isn't asking for something specific from your database. And so what we have to do next is figure out how to get the loops tied so that the user asks for something, you go ask the database for it, and you give it back to the user. Right now, it's all a one-way loop. We've only been using what are called get statements. And we have to do post statements so the user can post stuff back to the server to be operated upon. The easiest way to do this is through HTML forms. And an HTML form is basically just a shortcut way of encapsulating a bunch of stuff that you want to send back to the server when you submit that form, which can either be done by a button or it can be done by pressing enter in a text entry field, anything that causes a submit message, you tell it what to do with it. And what we're going to tell it to do with it is to invoke a post message to post this stuff back to the server. And when you post stuff back to the server, we'll then be able to poke through the data that was sent back to the server and then take some action on that data. And so the form is the basic step of this. So when a form is submitted, it calls a route. And remember that in a web server, you basically have routes defined, which are ways of handling certain sets of data that either come in as a request for a GET or as a POST where I'm sending data to the web server, or a couple others. There's put and delete, but we won't actually talk about put and delete much in this class. You don't need them for a basic application like we're talking about. So we're going to use form primarily as a tool to submit data. And what we're submitting is using GET and POST messages. We're going to use our first POST route today. We've only done GET routes previously. And what I mean by that, and I'm just going to flip over to my older code for a minute here, I was looking at the SQL EJS example that you all guys have been looking at so far. And where I define app GET at the root or app GET about, this is defining a GET route. So when an HTML GET request comes in, this is what I respond to that GET request with. Either with the contents of the database or with just a flat list on the about page or pointing off to one of my partials that's defined. Whatever I do to actually define that response, it's this route in the top level that I'm running Node on that defines what gets returned when that route is called. Does that make sense? So to use post messages, we're going to need to set up a post route in the example. And I'm now actually going to leave my SQL EJS and simple one.ejs behind and go to the new one that if you guys did a poll now, you'd see, which is SQL async. And I'll just kind of walk through some of the pieces and examples in this one. The first piece, though, is that I'm defining this post route for a query. And this is the first time in here that we're seeing actually something sent back to the server. In order to actually get the contents of what's coming back to the server, though, I want to have another piece of middleware in there. Remember when I defined the term middleware as being things that are taking low-level things and repackaging them so that you can access them in your code? NPM is a really good way of getting various pieces of middleware. In this case, there's one called body parser that takes all the stuff that's in your body of your post request or of your response post request rather, and just gives you the things that you want out of it. Just gives you the named variables that you've declared. So let me show you that live. If I am in here, and let me reopen some of my console logs. Here we go. I'll just open the body for right now. Let me run this puppy. Someday here it will start, so I'll find my way over to my server. And I think I'm still on 8,000, aren't I? Yeah, I'm still on 8,000. Good. So I'll load that. And then my screen is so big, I can't actually see my query results. There we go. So I'll actually just look for things in Sydney and run my query. And I should just get Sydney. But the interesting part I want to show off is what has happened over here on the server side. That I have just posted my query string Sydney as being the result of the body. And this came from this console log request body. If I had not been using my piece of middleware in here, I would instead get something that looks like console.log request. And that will give me the entirety of the request, which will be ugly. Ugly is good. Let me show you ugly. We get all our Victoria items. And over here, we get all this stuff. And it's good to know that all this stuff is here, because at some point, you may want some of all this stuff. For instance, some of the things that come across the type of browser that it's coming from, the server connection events that are going on, what its path is to get to you, write table states, sockets. But right now it's just stuff, and you actually really don't care that this is coming from a Mozilla 5.0 on Windows. This is just noise, having all of this stuff in there is a distraction. And so by using the Body Parser NPM plugin, we get rid of all this junk and can just focus on the pieces that we want, which are those messages that we've defined. And so that comes in by having NPM installed this Body Parser and then requiring it using the require statement at the top of our JavaScript here. So if you've just pulled, you've actually done this already with the normal NPM install. But if I was doing this for the first time, then I would have to do it by saying NPM install --- save body parser. And then that'll go ahead and put that into the right file to package.json file. So when anybody NPM installed, it would just get brought down automatically as one of the dependencies. Makes sense. Body parser helps parsing, comes in as an NPM dependency. So then we're going to grab variables off the request object, and there are any named variables that we had. This case, I have been naming those variables on the SQL async in the view. So if async one is what I've been defining here. And if I give an input ID of query string and then submit this, then that query string is going to come back with the contents of the input field. And that's how I get that input field coming over here to show up as, well, I guess I can show it again now, but to show up as that query string Sydney that I showed just a minute ago, or query string Victoria. Let me run that again just to... Why'd the whole thing come back again? Because I didn't save my stupid file. Sorry. So now I'm just getting my nice query string coming back with Sydney, or in fact, anything else that I typed in here. I'm of course not going to get results back for this, but I will get my gobbledygook string here back in my query string. So that's how I make the tie between the field that's being typed in and what is being returned from the post message to my web server that I can then take action on. So here we are back into something else that we talked about a few classes ago, this being asynchronous JavaScript. Something when you first start working with database queries that's going to bite you is you're going to forget that these are asynchronous queries and that by default the JavaScript execution is just going on to the next line immediately and not waiting for things. And there are a couple of ways to take care of this. The first is callbacks. Do you remember what a callback is? Where we actually have a function passed into something else, and that function is going to be called when that something else completes. In this case, if we look at what's going on, even in the version of the SQL example that you've been looking at, let's go back to SQL EJS example here. That query is being passed through as connection query, select star from stuff where location equals Sydney, and then passing in a function. And that function has error rows and fields, and somewhere in that function, we've got listings equal to rows. Now that function is not going to be called until this query returns with the results from the database. And so this is using a callback structure, even just for a simple returning of values to the variable that we've defined. And so what that means is that actually this connection end might get called before these results return. And it's only because it's a nicely written library that connection end will actually wait until it's done serving all the results it's been asked for before it actually ends. If I had a statement in here before that connection end, let's say console log rows is row zero is outputting the first row of our results. So if I were to say here console.log, hello. Do you think this hello line is going to appear before or after rows? Who says before? Who says after? Should actually be before, because this is a callback, which should wait some period of time for these database results to return before it completes. Let's see if that is actually true in real life or only in what should supposed to be happening. Yeah, there we go. See how hello comes back almost right away here, then the rest of the stuff is all waiting for it to be set up after the database results come in. So this is an example of synchronous JavaScript carrying on through and completing as much as it can, and then sometime, some indeterminate time later, particularly in computer cycles, a long period of time, because you have to go this network round trip to the database server and have the database server do lots of stuff and then come back to you, which in a computing cycle time is a long time. You're going to come back and execute those lines in the callback function well after everything else. Let me get back out of that. So there are other ways. We talked about, yep. Oh, in the statement on screen here, you mean?
Yeah.
Just because the way that I did my console log was just looking at row zero. Yeah. And so that's actually outputting the entire row from the database that's being returned not using the nice print statement that I had in my partial function. And so it actually should have the ID, the name, and the location. Whereas previously when I was printing on the screen, I was just using name and location.
Which one, ID 1 and 2, or just, is there
Oh, just because it happens that let's look at the actual structure of the database to answer that one, actually. Let's go to TestDB and make that my default. And in one of these, I ought to have my, heck, I don't have it here, but was this listings? What I'm asking for from stuff. What? Aren't I on test DB? Sorry, what I thought was going, oh, group zero DB. What I thought was going to be a quick answer to this turned out to be probably a longer way to answer this than. There we go. So I have my query string in here stuff where location equals Sydney as my default. And if I look at the actual contents of the table, this is everything that's in that table. I've got a unique ID for each item, and the only thing from Sydney happens to be ID number 3. And so what I'm getting are returned rows that are the result of that query select statement. And this is actually something that bears just a little bit of thinking about in that query select statement. In this form, I've been using it from a single table. But in fact, I could take multiple tables, do a join across those tables, do some complex query to get stuff back out of it. And what I get back is still just a list of rows. And so at the time I'm operating it in the rest of my my program, it's just rows that I get back. I don't care what the actual table structure underlying it was anymore. So there are a couple of ways of dealing with asynchronous behavior aside from the simple callback scheme that I just mentioned. We talked a little bit about promises last time. This was mechanism that came about in ES5, so we'd have to use a transpiler to access it. It was where we used the structure of creating a new promise, and then that promise resolves. And so we put our other things in the code behind a resolve statement. We also talked about the async await structure for doing this. Async await is actually not here in ES6 even, it's an ES7 feature. So again, we could use a transpiler to access it. It used a structure where you declare something asynchronous and then you await something completed before going on to the next bit. All of this is trying to get around that problem of a callback hell, where you have one callback that calls another callback that calls another callback, and before you know it, your code is indented 15 spaces deep and you are reading little three-character lines on your terminal. It just makes code look ugly and is a little bit hard to reason around and is structured poorly to think about, basically. Yeah. And so what I'm going to introduce in today's example, instead of using a transpiler, I thought about adding Babel to our stack for our build environment tools, and then kind of realized, no, this is going to be more complicated than it's worth, and didn't want to throw one more thing onto that stack. So instead, I chose to use an NPM module called async. Async provides a structure that is very close to async await, but that is available as an NPM module rather than having to change the type of JavaScript that you're writing. And so you'll once again go through the NPM install and require statements for that. Let's look at those. Var async equals require async, and that's going to pull in the async variable as being this library that is defined in the async NPM package. Before I used this, I still had to pull it in with NPM and set NPM install --- save async. Then after I have this async variable, where I want to use it is inside the query. Now, in this first one that populates when I open up the page, I actually haven't bothered with it. I've just gone and used that using the callback as it was, because I'm not really doing anything else with this. But I wanted to show the new async structure as a result of this post query. And this post query, I'm using this async series function. And what this means is that everything that's a function in this series is to be called in sequence. Wait for the first one to finish before you call the second one. And so I'm recreating my connection here. It's still group zero, still group zero DB. I'm defining another query here, select star from stuff where location is like something, and that something is the query string I'm getting back. Then go ahead and get the results of this query into a callback. And when that is done, call a callback saying the query is done. And this is the cue to the async library to say, go on to the next function in my series of functions. And so when I call this callback, I'm stacking a query done on my results queue, and then I'm going on to the next function in this series, which in this case is redirecting to display these new listings that I've just gotten back from my query. Does that make sense how async works? Of course. You don't. In fact, that --- save flag that I was using is causing the things that I add to be added to package.json. And so if I look at that package.json, this is the one that I don't edit by hand, but I automatically get edited by that save flag. It has added body parser and async to the package.json, which means that when you say npm install, it's going to bring down all the dependencies, and you don't have to specify them individually like that. That's right. After you pull this, you'll have to do an npm install again, and we'll get all those. The reason I've been showing you, though, the --- save and installing them manually is that you might find for your project that you have an npm module that does something cool for you that you want to use. And if you're going to use it, you'll have to use that save flag so that it installs properly. So if there are no immediate async issues, I'm going to go ahead and cruise on through. Before that, I don't quite feel like I've walked through this example enough. let me talk about a couple other things that I probably should have built slides for and just kind of walk through the code logic a bit before we go on to that exercise too. So I'm going to close my Chrome Developer Tools. It's not doing anything good for me. I am on localhost. This is not where I want. Oh, yeah, it is still. Oh, but I think I'm not actually running, am I? No, I'm not. Okay, great. I don't want EJS. I want async. Good, that's better. Can I get query? Of course you can. Okay, so I'm initially when I come into this page seeing all of my results. The reason I'm seeing all of my results over here in SQL Async, and I'm going to just clean up a little bit here, closing a couple of these pages. That in SQL Async, the first thing I do when I load the page is select star from stuff. Stuff is just the name of the database or the table that I'm looking at. That's part of the Group Zero DB database. Then I am populating this listings variable. So this could be called anything I want it to be. It just has to match what I declare my variable as and what I pass in my variable as when I'm passing through the partial. But other than that, it doesn't matter what that's called. Interestingly, you'll see when I select one listings, it's going to highlight everywhere else that listings is being used. And it's not highlighting this listings because this listings is actually not this listings. That's confusing. Let me pass this in instead as list, not listings. And the only place that that has to match is when I go through and look at my async partial here. If I am passing it in as list, I have to receive it as list. And nothing else over here matters. It doesn't need to match items. At one point that was matching. It doesn't need to match anywhere else on here. It's just that I'm passing in a list of items. When I pass it in from this side, from the SQL Async side, the way this render statement reads is render the async 1.ejs from the views directory and pass it a variable list which contains listings. And so this list is an object that contains all the rows of the database that I'm getting back from this query as listings. So over here on this side, on the partial side, it's basically just exactly as we've been talking about on the output side, that I'm going through the list of for each and putting the name and the location in there for each of them. We've talked through a little bit what's happening on the form side. So I'm declaring this new form that is calling the root query with a post method. And it's doing that when it submits. And so I'm just putting a little bit of text there. I'm putting a label there. I'm putting my input field there, and I'm putting a button to submit there. Now, this means there are actually two ways that I can cause a submit event on this form. I can cause a submit event by pressing enter when I'm inside the input field, or I can explicitly press the query button. These both do the same thing. They both cause a submit, and when that submit happens, it's calling a post method on the query root, and that query root, of course, is defined over here in SQL async.js. So let's look at that query root. We've got at post query, that's a function that has a request and a response. And the request is where I was talking about not getting the entire request, but just getting the request body. And then I'm starting this series function where I'm creating the connection to the database, giving it my credentials, connecting to it. I am setting up my select statement, select star from stuff where location is like. And this like term is something that's a little bit looser than an equals term in SQL. An equal means it must be exactly this thing I'm setting it to. A like term means that I can use wildcards. It's often not as sensitive to things like a case. It basically is a looser version of equal for doing a where statement. And so, for instance, that means that I could do something in here of saying S star, or S percent, rather, and that ought to, that will give me a nice big error. Okay. Why is list not defined? Oh, because I have gotten halfway through editing and have not saved and restarted my server side, but have saved and automatically restarted my client side, because that picks that client up immediately. Sorry, that was confusing. What's going on here is that changes to your partial, the EJS, get picked up immediately because that's being served to the client and is running in the browser. Changes to your JS file that is being run by node.js don't actually get picked up until node.js runs again. And so when I got that error, I had my node.js, the server side, and the client side out of sync in what I just called that variable. So now if I call it S star, I should get things that complete with Sydney. And the reason that S percent worked, not S star, sorry, S percent worked was because I had that like rather than an exact equals. If I had an exact equals there, then that wouldn't have worked. So let's see, moving along, the where location like, and then I'm using request.body.query string. And the way I know to do that is just because what came back was this query string, and so that's in the body. And so I know I can refer to that using the same dot notation that I do with any other JSON that's coming back. And we'll talk about JSON again towards the end of today, but this is just JSON that this is returning. And I can treat any JSON object with that dot notation. Yeah.
But for if you want to do from whatever
data
it is,
yep.
So how would you write?
You'll actually use a date greater than and date less than, and you get things in between that range. It's a little bit tricky to write date select statements in SQL, but only because the format's very specific. Let's see. So in here, query string, I'm just building the query string into a variable, and then I'm calling connection query with that query string then feeding it back into a function. Just like I talked about a minute ago, when that function is done running, it's going to call a callback saying the query is done, and that's going to be the thing that tells async that it can go on to the next function, which is causing a redirect to root. This is something that bears a little bit of thinking about and talking about here, is that when I first came into this page, without having done anything on the query side, I had populated my listings here, then I have on my that's a confusing way of stating that, on the slash root, the root at the base of my web pages, so root, R-O-O-T, root, R-O-U-T-E, I have defined this as merely calling the async one partial, passing in list as listings here. When I come back down here, I am just repopulating the listings variable with the rows that I get from my new select query. And then since I have those listings updated, and it's not going to call back to this code that was called at the start of entering this function, or this entire JS file, rather, that's been run once and doesn't have any reason to rerun. So my new updated listings form the listings variable that is then passed into async one. And it means that rather than having to define a new web page for showing my query results, I can simply pass it back to the root of my web page. And because that listings variable has been updated, it will show the new query results. It's a shortcut way of not having to rewrite the code that I wrote to display my query over and over again. And has the side benefit of when I am on here, for instance, I type Victoria and run the query, you're really not going to see anything flashing. Because it already has the page loaded, and you're simply bringing back up the page with new query results in it. that you really see a whole lot less bouncing around than if you were going to a different page that you might have laid out slightly differently or headspace is somewhere different. So the user experience when you actually just go back to the same route with the variables updated is a much nicer one of seeming like the page is just updating rather than getting the whole flashing of the page being reloaded. Sure. If I wanted to in here, do like I did in the previous example of a select star from stuff where, oh, I don't know. What else do I have in here? Where ID is equal to 3. And this is on the server side, so I'm going to have to restart it. This is in here, so now that it's restarted, I'm going to have to refresh that. Hey, I'm going to have to refresh that. Hey, didn't that hit ID equal 3? Oh, but, I am slightly confused only because I shouldn't have three things that are an ID 3. Oh, I do though, don't I? Yeah. Ah, okay. It was smarter than I am. I never updated my table properly when I was entering item. I thought I gave them all unique IDs, but I did not. I must not have updated my insert statements. Thanks for catching that. Cool. So yes, that initial query could have been anything. I just defined it as all of them as a convenient place to start. So I think that probably explains all the pieces that I wanted to in this updated async example. I've left the about page just exactly as it was. It's not going to a database or anything else. It's just a demonstration of static EJS partials. But that can stay there or change, whatever you like. Any questions on how this async example is set up? Okay. I'm going to let you guys loose on exercise 2 for a while then. I'm asking you to do a couple other things in this. So the first thing is that I'm asking you to create a branch in your fork of Simple Node. We've talked about branching, but I haven't asked you to do it explicitly yet. What a branch is something that you are working in that you want to do a little bit of test development, but you don't necessarily want it to affect your main line code. I will very often create a branch when I'm doing a risky development path and I want to just try something out. Then I'll see if it works in that branch. And if it does, then I'll merge it with my main branch. And that's how I'll keep the master branch or main branch of my project clean and working all the time. So in this case, I'm asking you to create a branch. You can create a branch and check out code to that branch all in one step by using the -b flag to check out. So git checkout -b and then a branch name, and you can call this whatever you want it to be. Then create your own example page. Feel free to copy some of what you need from my async example, but I'd like you actually to create your own page. Using the TestDB database and the employees table, create a page that allows you to query by salary or one of the other fields from that test database. And this is basically just a way of getting you to work with that async code and try out a new example on it. If you want, this is kind of jumping ahead, but you could do this on your own data from your own project instead. A variant of this will be this week's homework. So if you actually feel like you're likely to need significant help in this section, skip doing it on employees database, start doing it on your project database, and then you get a leg up on the homework. Probably shouldn't have mentioned that, but it's getting late. And now if you have control A and B, that will be captured on the screen session. And so now you're no longer in the screen session, but it's still running in the background.
And I can just close
it. And you can close this or whatever else, you should be able to refresh it.
Okay. 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 Yeah.
From SimpleNode. Yeah. Because you're checking out a branch on the SimpleNode version. And in this case, if you're a fork of SimpleNode.
So I'll get my second.
You will not. You'll actually get all of these files replaced by files in your branch. Exactly. And so git branch will always play what you You will. Absolutely, you will. And this is one of the reasons that all of the branch will be.
You're welcome.
I mean, if I were a truth in this, I'd walk around the stage like you did. Yeah, so if you're online, you can hit the...
Hey, Sean, I've had a look at your guys' page now, so feel free to put something else up there if you want to reuse that port for stuff you're working on today.
Okay.
Same with you, Randy. I've had a look at your homework now, so feel free to reuse that port for something else.
And you guys, too, if you want to...
Yours looks great too, Ricky. Feel free to use that port for whatever else you're working on.
Yeah.
So I would like you actually to ignore the pieces that I have here for the fact that people who are in the position Okay, so this one is done. So I think actually, are you presenting the possible best? So let's And then you should go back to the right page and hit refresh. And so it's 7240, which is showing you that it has that number of rows, which is not going to do it, but it's just not pretty much the right value. The first is the columns hold, so we get two is the column style. So let's pop back over to your simple one website. And come over here, it is in that loop. Where you would actually so there's no name or destination in there.
And we're going back here. Hold on a second, I want to walk so you can take it.
So,
So we don't want to say did check out and get that new song.
You're not yet, but you're one of give you a check up for you. That's burned away.
Oh, can I try one more time? Okay. I don't actually know. So my process for creating new files is actually usually you start the day. So touch in the file. And we'll say touch the IDKS or whatever and we'll show up. And I was never really kind of been aware of quantity that way. It was probably never what you just
have. Because it won't feel that
way. Right.
There's all these.
Yeah, okay. Definitely. So something in your so since there are no changes on this, what I would suggest is going to your server as CD or control C or CD dot dot equals.
Control
C. That just breaks out your node server. Oh, yeah, there we are. CD space dot dot. That's how you do it. CD space dot dot has your point. It's not a Git directory, yeah, so that's fine. Yeah, so I'm going to ignore that. So your simple mount is gone, so you'll have to get cloned. You don't have that? Hi, guys.
And you save them in search of free? And specifically to save you can get add first and correct make and hold it on the server like this. Yeah, just and actually, I might suggest So I think here we've got a whole bunch of stuff to do, and we've got two files that we can use for that. Let's build in here a page that you just did this. So I guess we first need to make a database. Let's, did you install the message board? Let's do, since you're on a Mac, let's actually do a step. You should support Pro.
Group four.
And the host is so we use group four of the database and let's create a create table card. And we're going to have to actually use a little bit different
yes. Let me well, that'll work.
That's the syntax. So you could say, and let's call your table cards. Let's think about what the fuel will be for your cards. And you might want to give an aspect of the structure. So I'm kind of presuming that somewhere that I feel like what's my card for the local group. And so that's all of these are So I would use this kind of format to say, I need space integer.
Excellent. I don't know if this might be a reserved word in SQL. So let's create a history paragraph or dragon. We have.
Ways. And so insert's going to be using a syntax more like that. And so insert into cards. Here's what we're actually. Yeah, so let's fill out one and then we'll just pop this is the ID call. And let's run this query just to make sure. Yeah, run one more on that. So get get into the equal now. And so you should be able to tell the current now. Let's not bother and we'll put a bunch more things in the color. Just get a bunch of items in there. So for copy that. Open,
So now what I would do is raise all these and say, let's start with the first. Yeah, perfect. Okay. So if someone has got put in more than once and there's 2 months here. So we have a data, when they risk it, that's probably a project that's called. Do we actually have that deployment before the if you're a visual figure coach or a visual coach,
Oh, yeah.
And let's
behind you and just look up and notice.
Yeah, great. So we're just saying we're getting everything from the current database and we're going to return those for the best listings. So now we can open a new terminal. And say
SSH.
And now if you say get clone and go find your clone in the US. And so here you could just say the node that's resolved by the DNS and screen is basically just a way of launching the terminal window to start this. It doesn't shut down when you close it. And now say node this is and so now we're able to go to the window with browser and this sets us up pretty close to be able to move on to the next bit. Yeah, so kind of module async means whether it can impact the it is not. What I'm wondering, you must be in your fork and didn't update my fork stuff. And so here's where I wouldn't do it that way. I never ever edit directly based on and so if in here instead you say take the small and you're probably also going to have to do the same thing now with the body that and then that's so it's a pretty weird thing to actually get into reverse.
only one check when you're running on 1481.
Okay. You took all the text? Okay. So, of your simple ones that they ask, they come up the items that work on the items.
You guys get along with it?
Feel free if you've got the internet exercise, keep them in the interface and come on to the homework list.
How do you guys get along?
I'm not actually sure how to call it. So you get your railroads with the title description and category goes on and we're still with that paragraph actually. And again, instead of you don't want it back because you want it to be less than that employee's title and employee's title. Make sure that your title is okay, well, let me see if they're going to log in for you. Okay. which must mean that we have edited the front line files that comprehend your project but not actually on the front. So why Berkshire is one of those companies that is
So, what we just did with the SQL DJS, since you've so in SQL, it's the one where so let's try and do it for the model of the cars class connection. This is and then that as the asynchronous version of what it was putting in mind. The only other thing in addition to that, we also have the other groups in let's figure out how a greater than query works. You gotta take off. Oh, we're almost done, aren't we? Yeah. Are you? Let me go ahead and turn on
anybody have a quick last minute thing before we get started?
Awesome.
That was a quick, wonderful one. You should have just been loud and cheering for this part.
There was.
Yeah, so that is saying that your syntax is incorrect. That's not true. So it's the end thing. But it comes from your
Thank you.
but start from the refund, whatever that is. You don't have a first aid plan. If you're using that as a you take your flights and your coaches on the that's not how we get back into my support work plan and just sort of worry and figure exactly what the support you might be wanting to again and put that line with the meeting.
Okay.
Yep. Okay. Oh, okay. I think this is probably because remember you have two simple statements. You have two listings of reasons that on the computer are really numbers. Right there, that work category. And so, that's the one that's getting test damage. For some reason, that did not work properly. And I think so you're over there, like safe.
Okay, let's jump on to the last few things before we run out of time here, and I had a couple more things I wanted to quickly chat about. We were going to chat almost not at all about JSON and RESTful API standards because nobody cares and it doesn't matter and it won't affect your projects. That's not entirely true. I care, but I might be the only one. So let's skip JSON and RESTful APIs. You're going to hear, if you go on in computer science, a lot about RESTful APIs, and we've actually been using them, and we've actually been using JSON, but the terminology isn't actually all that important right here. I wanted to talk for a minute, though, about next week and kind of what expectations were for the projects. So this is next week that Project 3 is due, I expect these to be kind of quick and easy, and they should follow on from what we've been doing on the homeworks, and so I don't expect this to be a whole elaborate production beyond what we've been adding to Project 2, except for the addition of this query from a database to show a list of things. And I think in all of your Project 2 feedback, I gave something that could be added that showed a list of stuff from a database. So I think it should basically be plugging in the homework exercise from this week and the stuff we just did in the exercise in class here, right, and plugging it onto one of your pages. And so in the demo next week, 5 points over the presentation of it. And so what I mean by that is that you're able to give a smooth presentation through one demo path. I don't care if things off of that demo path don't work. But I want you to be able to give a smooth story of you're looking at a textbook purchase site, if you do a query here for books in good condition, then these results show up and you can click on them and buy them. If the only thing that works is the results showing up and the click on and buy doesn't, well, you talk about it, you don't click it. It's the smoke and mirrors demo with some little part of it being actually calling from the server and not just smoke and mirrors. And that some little part is what you define as your Project 3 server round trip component. And from my standpoint, if you can tell a good story and you have one piece that works against the server, you know enough that if you had to, you could build the rest out against the server and it would just take more time and more work. So that's all I'm looking for there. Presentation component is it a smooth story through some piece of server functionality? If 5 points is, does the database design and function actually work? Do you have tables in your database that have the information in there that you need to get back out? And this was the stuff from last week's exercise. So I think you should all actually have something in a database now that can work for you. I want you to talk a little bit during this point about any problems you ran into, how it's connecting it, what kind of things were difficult, what broke on the way. Tell a little bit of a development story around this stuff. And then the last one doesn't really come into your presentation as well. When I go back and look at your code, is it a spaghetti or rat's nest, or is it a nice clean with some comments here and there, a bit of code? And so I'm going to do a little bit of feedback on code quality that was in there. And so try and clean it up and make it look somewhat decent and put some good comments so I can tell what I'm looking at when I'm in there and stuff. But that's it. It should be a maximum of 10 minutes. If you go less than 10 minutes and still tell a good story and still have a good demo, great. I'm not hung up on the length of the thing, really. You should not be going through the things that you did in project one of why you're doing the project, of what the user story is behind it, what the design story is behind it. We had all those in the project one demo presentation. And so this is just kind of an extension of that. It should be really kind of what's these last parts in the development process of it. I do, though, in your functionality demo, where you're giving this run through, to work on getting it smooth. Pretend that you've got an investor sitting in front of you, and they're deciding whether to fund this project and pay you $1 million for building the rest of the thing out. And so you want to make it really kind of a compelling demo of here's why it's good, here's why it looks good, here's why it's useful, have a good pattern behind it, making it look good. That's kind of the deal with Project 3. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. So in Project 1 in the demo, people spent a lot of time delving into who are the users, how are they going to use it, how do we validate them, what's the market potential of this, and I want that encapsulated for like 30 seconds. Here's why the website's interesting. Here's a piece that's built out. Look at it function. Isn't this great? You should give us a bunch of money to build the rest of it out. And so think of it as an elevator pitch to the Project 1 presentation. Project 3 questions? Okay, cool. The reason I was setting things up with APIs and JSON discussion is that the way I'd intended next week to work is that we'll go through project presentations first. That means you aren't sitting there kind of worrying about your project presentation and half listening. And then that'll hopefully take only about half of the class. Second half of the class, I intend to give some demos of web APIs, web service calls you can make that you can do interesting things in your website. But at that point, every single bit of grade from the class is over. And if you have an exam to study for or something else, you can run away and I won't be offended. But there is cool stuff we'll show off after the presentations next week if you want to stick around. And get on Slack and ask me questions if you have any problems about Project 3. Thanks. Okay, so let's get a less than query. Yeah, it is. And so that's the one I would have thought would have worked. Let me stop sharing so I actually have a fast machine in rather than a slow pokey machine.